Simon & Schuster Audio presents Memorials, a novel by Richard Chizmar, read by Michael Crouch and Jonathan Todd Ross.
For Richard Gallagher, with gratitude and admiration. And what rough beast, its hour come round at last, slouches towards Bethlehem to be born. William Butler Yeats, The Second Coming.
Project Proposal. Date, April 18th, 1983. Class, American Studies, 301. Instructor, Professor Tyree. Group Members, William Anderson, Troy Carpenter, Melody Wise. Roadside Memorials, A Study of Grief and Remembrance. We've all seen them, on our way to the grocery store or the post office or a faraway vacation destination. Keeping a lonely vigil on the side of the road, stark white crosses surrounded by candles and photographs, stuffed animals and flowers, ceramic angels and red or yellow ribbons. We slow down to take a look, shake our heads in regret, and then continue on our way, and they're forgotten. Roadside memorials not only honor the accidental death of a loved one, but they also play an important role in the grieving process for surviving family members and friends. They often form a connective thread of remembrance and help survivors to maintain an emotional bond with the departed. Roadside memorials originated in the early 1800s, most prominently in the American Southwest, especially in what is now Arizona, New Mexico, and Texas. Many Latin Americans placed such memorials to mark the location where their loved ones died. The first documented memorial to appear on the East Coast was in Connecticut in 1812. Now, in 1983, there are thousands of such memorials scattered around the nation's bustling highways, suburban streets, and remote backroads. So many, in fact, that there is talk of legislation and regulation in some states, towns, counties, even outright bans. But for now, these emotionally charged shrines remain a relatively new and increasingly controversial development. And behind each of them is a story. Our group proposes to travel by automobile throughout central and northwestern Pennsylvania on a 5-day road trip. Utilizing a variety of visual mediums, still photography, film, and video, we plan to create a 60 to 75 minute documentary entitled Roadside Memorials, A Study of Grief and Remembrance. This visual presentation will be supplemented by dramatic commentary, as well as personal interviews with family members and close friends of the accident victims. We will begin our journey on the campus of York College and then travel north via I-83 and a network of back roads, following the shoreline of the Susquehanna River. On our first night, we will stop in Sudbury, Pennsylvania, the hometown of group member Billy Anderson, where a very personal roadside memorial dedicated to his late mother and father still stands. From there, we will navigate a winding path to the northwest, venturing deep into the heart of Pennsylvania's Appalachian region. We will drive without a pre-planned route, wandering with a purpose, searching for roadside memorials, and attempting to discover the heart-wrenching stories behind them. Video footage. 8:43 a.m., Friday, May 6th, 1983. The sound of muffled voices over a dark screen. After a moment, the lens cap is removed, and we are greeted by blue sky and bright sunshine. The camera angle shifts, and we see an orange Volkswagen van with black side panels parked at the curb. The rear double doors are standing open. Off to the side, on the nearby sidewalk, is a jumbled heap of what appears to be camping gear. Knapsacks, a fishing pole, a rolled-up tent, a pair of lanterns, and folded-up lawn chairs. There are also two large Coleman coolers and a half-dozen brown paper grocery bags filled with packaged food. A young woman, olive skin, dark eyes, long brown hair tied back in a ponytail, wearing a yellow sundress and white high-top Chuck Taylor All-Star sneakers, emerges from the back of the van. She appears out of breath. A sheen of perspiration glistens on her bare arms. The camera zooms close. She sees it and sticks out her tongue. "Camera equipment's all loaded," she says. "What do you think? Food next, then the gear?" "I think Billy should put down the camera and help pack the van," an off-screen voice says. "We're already behind schedule." A young man carrying two grocery bags appears in frame. Brown-skinned and diminutive, he's dressed in tan khaki shorts and a matching button-down shirt. A red bandana is tied loosely around his neck. He's wearing thick-framed glasses, and his hair is styled in a large afro. From behind the camera, a cheerful male voice announces, "Meet Troy Carpenter, ladies and gents. Say something, Carp." Troy places the bags in the back of the van and glances over his shoulder. Adjusting his eyeglasses, he frowns and says, "Something." The man holding the camera groans and slowly pans to the roadside, where their female companion is leaning over to pick up a grocery bag. "Your turn, Mel. Introduce yourself to our adoring audience." She spins around, her face lighting up into a million-dollar smile. Her teeth are very white and perfectly straight. We see a scattering of freckles across her nose and cheeks as she gives the camera a flirty wave. "Hello, adoring audience. My name's Melody Wise. I'm here in York, Pennsylvania, on this beautiful Friday morning with the grumpy boy wonder Troy Carpenter," she gestures at the camera, "as well as Billy the Kid Anderson, our esteemed camera operator. As soon as we finish loading up the van, we're hitting the road in search of life's and death's eternal truths." Her smile fades, and she shrugs. "That's all I got. I'm still half asleep." "You did great," Billy replies. And we see his blurry thumbs-up surface in front of the lens. And then, the screen goes dark and silent.
Day 1. Friday, May 6th. 1. Later, when the trip went bad, I would remember the bleeding man on the bicycle and wonder if he was a sign of things to come. 2. The van, a Volkswagen Westphalia pop-top camper that, from the moment I first laid eyes on it, reminded me of the mystery machine from Scooby-Doo, belonged to Melody's sister. Tamara Wise was 6 years older than Melody and more of a mother figure than a sibling. She'd bought the van used from an old stoner who manned the ticket booth at a drive-in movie theater in Richmond, Virginia, where Tamara worked as a secretary in a real estate office. It was the first vehicle she'd ever owned, and she was very proud of it. Once she managed to accumulate enough vacation days, she and her boyfriend planned to hit the road and explore the coastline of New England, something she'd dreamed about doing ever since she was little. After a lengthy and at times rocky negotiation, Tamara agreed to rent the van to us for the princely sum of $300. I'd bitched and moaned about unfair price gouging, but after Troy pointed out how much money we'd be saving by not having to pay for nightly hotel rooms, the numbers didn't look so bad. In the end, we each agreed to chip in $100 and share the cost of gas. To add insult to injury, Tamara's rental agreement came with a handwritten list of rules and regulations. "No smoking cigarettes or weed inside the van." Tamara was, of course, allergic. "No eating food of any kind inside the van." Can you see me rolling my eyes? "The van must be returned within 7 days with the exterior washed and the interior vacuumed." Reasonable enough. Photocopies of both my and Troy's driver's licenses must accompany cash payment of the rental fee, just in case the entire trip was an elaborate ruse to kidnap and murder Melody. And last but certainly not least, Melody Wise, and only Melody Wise, was authorized to drive the van. No sweat off my back. I had no desire to drive that toaster on wheels. At the bottom of the lined sheet of notebook paper upon which the rules were listed, Tamara had scribbled her name. Directly below, she'd neatly printed each of our names and drawn lines next to them. Melody and Troy had dutifully complied with their signatures. I had not. In a gesture of silent protest, I'd scrawled William Shatner in chicken scratch. For as long as I could remember, Star Trek had been my father's favorite television show. Either no one noticed what I'd done or they decided not to say anything.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.